Дякую за можливість задати запитання. Добре. Шановний пане посол, ви багато говорили про Україну, переважно критично. Давайте поговоримо про Європейський Союз також. Для мене Європейський Союз – це як лебідь, рак і щука. Це поєднання країн маленьких і великих. Країн зі стабільною економікою і з великими боргами. Країн, які входять до зони євро і не входять. Входять до Шенгену і не входять. І так далі, і так далі. І це як поєднання непоєднуваних речей. Ви посол Європейського Союзу в Україні. Напевне, ви є оптимістом щодо майбутнього Європейського Союзу. Які у вас є об'єктивні підстави для такого оптимізму?
Після кризису.
Дуже цікаво, до речі.
Well, first of all, I think I haven't talked about the European Union itself until now, so I don't know why you lead the conclusion that I'm optimistic, but I hope I'm optimistic. Anyway, what you call a union with a lot of differences and a lot of belonging to different the parts of integration, Schengen, Euro and so on. Well, the European Union is not the Soviet Union. That is the main difference, is that you are used to a Soviet Union, where in Moscow they decided everything, how all the different independent republics should behave and abide and so on. The European Union is a different process. It's a process which started with some countries, gradually devolving their parts of their sovereignty to a common European project. And this project, over 60 years, has delivered to Europe what nothing has delivered in all the history of Europe, which is 60 years of peace, prosperity, democracy, and all that goes with that. And of course, as it is not, Brussels is not the Kremlin and the Soviet Union of the time, Brussels cannot dictate to the sovereign states who are part of the European Union to what degree they each have to relinquish their parts of sovereignty in favor of the European project. This is a process that is done gradually as they themselves want to deepen that integration. Also, we have to take into account that there were various waves of enlargement and that these enlargement waves took with it several different obligations, and also that different members of the European Union also have different approaches to how deepen the European Union project should be. If I give you an example, for instance, all the countries who joined the European Union after the adoption of the euro have a commitment to join the euro. But there is no decision in Brussels to say, Poland, next week you are going to join the euro, and Czech Republic, in 2 weeks you are going to join the euro. Now, each country will have to follow a process, but they have a commitment to join the euro. There are other countries which joined before that, which have no commitment to join the euro. For instance, the United Kingdom. They have some time ago expressed that wish, but then they abandoned the idea. I mean, of course, there are those countries which have specific interests, and they are allowed within this family to keep those specific interests. The same to Schengen, for instance. There are countries who are not members of the European Union who are members of Schengen. For instance, Switzerland, Norway, are members of Schengen, they are not members of the European Union. So the European Union is open and is not a top-down, let's say, organization. It is an organization which welcomes those who want to share certain values and objectives, and those which have joined in a time where certain of these requirements were not there, are allowed to continue without being fully participating in all the European policies. Regarding the problems that the European Union has, indeed it has problems. The problems are mainly derived from the fact that 10 years or so ago there was the adoption of a monetary union, euro, but this monetary union was not accompanied by economic union, which, and again, because the countries, the member states, retained levels of sovereignty that are incompatible with their obligations with certain of the policies, in particular the euro, the policy of the euro, which is leading to the situation today that some countries went beyond their means, some countries have not had transparent public finance management towards the European institutions. The European Commission, for instance, already several years ago have asked to conduct with the European Union Statistical Office the statistics on public finance management in countries, for instance, like Greece. And member states said, no, no, this is not for you. This is for each country to look into those matters. Today, following the examples that have occurred, you know that the European Union is taken creating new institutions, new mechanisms, and having more competencies that will allow them to look into these problems. We learn by mistake, it is true, but again, we are a union where in the end, when the problems reach certain levels, normally they have produced more competencies to the Union rather than less competencies to the Union. And I think this is what the history has demonstrated until now. I hope that this crisis will demonstrate that again, and that in the future Europe will be stronger from these shortcomings.